Dear students, in this session we will learn about few genetic diseases. Examples: alkaptonuria, albinism, galactosemia, cystic fibrosis and thalassemia. Now, what happens in these diseases is that these diseases are called genetic diseases because that results because of improper functioning of certain enzymes which are related to the genes in that particular individual. And such kind of disorders, they are heritable disorders. That means it runs in your family. So, because they are inherited through genes, they are called as genetic diseases. I am Dr. Lata, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Maharani Science College for Women, Bengaluru. And today we will learn in detail about few genetic disorders, like what are the causes, what are the characteristics of this disease, and how they can be treated or how they are diagnosed. Now let's learn one by one. So these are the different genetic diseases that we will be learning in detail. First, let's understand what genetic diseases are. And then we will learn about alkaptonuria, albinism, galactosemia, cystic fibrosis and thalassemia. Now, a genetic disease is caused by an abnormality in the genetic makeup of an individual, and hence they are termed as genetic diseases. Now, when we say it is an abnormality, and that abnormality can range from a discrete mutation in a single base in the DNA of a single gene, or to a gross chromosomal abnormality involving addition, deletion, or altering any structure of the chromosome, or even the addition or missing of a chromosome, like we have already learned in our previous topics where we learned about chromosomal abnormalities. So when some people inherit these genetic disorders from their parents, while acquired changes or mutations in a pre-existing gene or a group of genes cause other genetic diseases. Now this genetic mutation can occur either randomly or due to some environmental exposures, which in turn results in these genetic disorders. Now in this group, first let's learn about alkaptonuria. Now there is an amino acid called as phenylalanine, and the improper metabolism of this phenylalanine, if this particular amino acid is not metabolized properly, it results in three main diseases. One is phenylketonuria, the other one is alkaptonuria, and the third one is albinism. Now in phenylketonuria, what happens, the phenyl alanine hydroxylase, that particular enzyme goes missing, because of which the phenylalanine will not be metabolized properly, and hence it results in phenylketonuria. Now what happens in alkaptonuria? Now if you look at these pictures, they explain you the main characteristic features of alkaptonuria. Now what are you finding here? You can find one black spot in the eye, you can see the blackening of the cartilage in the ear. So this condition we call it as ochronosis. And then if you see here, there are two bottles which contains urine. The yellow color one is the normal urine, the other one is the urine which has turned black, and that is a urine collected from the person suffering from alkaptonuria. Now this black urine is one more characteristic feature of this alkaptonuria, and because of that it is also called as black urine disease. Now let us further understand the other characters of this alkaptonuria. So it is called as black urine disease because urine, when it gets exposed to oxygen or to air, it turns black, and hence the name black urine disease. It is an inherited genetic disorder of phenylalanine and tyrosine metabolism. It is autosomal recessive in inheritance. We will see in the next slide as to how this autosomal recessive inheritance takes place. and then ochronosis, which is a building up of dark pigment in the cartilage and skin. It is a very prominent feature of alkaptonuria, and it affects 1 in 1 million worldwide. So their occurrence is rare, but it do happen. Now, we said it is autosomal recessive in inheritance. How these genes get inherited in this autosomal recessive pattern? For example, male and a female, both they are the carrier of this mutation. That means they do not show the symptoms, they are not affected. Okay, this gene is present on the autosome, and they show one of the chromosome showing this affected gene and the other one being a normal chromosome. They'll be the carriers. So when they both get married, the chances of them having children is 4 out of 4, two females and two males. Among all these, one will be affected because she receives both the chromosomes, like one chromosome from the father and one from the mother, both carrying this mutated allele, and hence she will be the affected one. Okay, and the other two children, one son and one daughter, they will be just carrying the mutation, so they will be the carriers, they will not show any kind of symptoms, and the other child will be perfectly normal. So the chances of getting this autosomal recessive disorder is 1 to 3, like out of 4 individuals, one will get affected, 2 will be carrier and 1 will be perfectly normal. So this is how they receive the affected or the mutated gene through autosomal recessive inheritance. Now, what causes this disease? What causes alkaptonuria? It's the mutation in the HGD gene, that is homogentisic acid oxidase, is the gene. I mean, that is the enzyme that goes missing because of the mutation in HGD gene, which results in alkaptonuria. Now, what happens when this particular enzyme goes missing? Then it will be unable to break down this amino acid phenylalanine and tyrosine into their further products. Because of that, it results in the accumulation of a compound called as homogentisic acid. It gets accumulated in the skin, the cartilage and other body tissues, and hence it results in ochronosis, or the blackening of the cartilage occurs because of this. Then it gets excreted through you. When the excess of this homogentisic acid that is there, that get excreted through urine. And this homogentisic acid, when it gets exposed to air, it makes the urine turn black, and hence the name black urine disease. Now, this is the biochemical pathway that shows like how the metabolism of phenylalanine and tyrosine that gets obstructed, that is when the homogentisic acid is formed, that is obstructed because of the absence of this enzyme homogentisic acid oxidase, and hence it results in alkaptonuria. Now, why homogentisic acid oxidase is not produced? Because of the mutation in one of the gene, that is HGD gene, which is responsible for the formation of this enzyme. Okay, so once this enzyme is lacking, then homogentisic acid will not get converted to carbon dioxide and water. Rather, it starts accumulating in the urine, in the body tissues, and it gets excreted through urine and resulting in black urine. Now, what are the tests or the treatment for this? Now, the test that is commonly performed is the urine analysis with ferric chloride. And if you add ferric chloride to the urine and leave it outside for a few minutes, it turns black in affected individuals, showing the higher composition of homogentisic acid, and hence turning black. Now, how it can be controlled? What is the treatment for this? So, high dose of vitamin C is recommended, which which slows down the development of arthritis in this affected individuals. Other than that, the disease can be managed, the symptoms can be managed, but there is no permanent cure for this because it is a genetically inherited disorder. Unless the mutated gene is manipulated and taken care of, there is no correction is possible. So that is with respect to alkaptonuria. The other disease which results by improper metabolism of phenylalanine is albinism. Now, what is albinism? You must have heard about this term, albino rats, which are white in color. So if you look at this picture, all these animals are albinic because they are all white in color. The peacock or the the squirrel, the dog and the bug, it's all white in color because they show lack of pigmentation. So albinism is a disease concerned with lack of pigmentation. Now, what are the characteristic feature of this? That shows very little or no melanin in eyes, skin and hair. Then people having this albinism will have some vision problems. Their skin and hair will be very pale. They are sensitive to sunburn and sunlight because they lack pigmentation in their skin. And again, this is autosomal recessive in inheritance. Now, this is a pathway that shows you like how an improper metabolism of phenylalanine and tyrosine give rise to alkaptonuria, the albinism and phenylketonuria. Now here, if you look at the horizontal line, the phenylalanine that gets converted to tyrosine. Tyrosine should give rise to DOPA, and this DOPA should get converted or it should get metabolized to form melanin pigment. But here what happens, the DOPA will not get converted to melanin pigment because of the absence of certain enzymes which are required for this conversion, and because of that it results in albinism. Now we said that is also autosomal recessive in inheritance, and this is how it gets passed on from one generation to the other. Like atypical autosomal recessive inheritance, when both the carriers get married, that out of four children one will be affected because she receives the abnormal two copies of the abnormal gene, and the other two will be carriers because they receive one copy of abnormal gene and the other normal one, and the normal one will obviously dominate over the affected one, which is recessive. So they'll be carriers and one will be perfectly all right, the normal child, because he receives two copies of the normal genes. Now, what's the treatment for this? There is no permanent cure for this. Only symptoms can be used, can be eased out. Skin burn and other things can be taken care of by the use of sunscreen and UV protective clothing. So that's how albinism can be controlled. So these are two genetic diseases that were concerned with the metabolism of phenylalanine. Now moving on, the next disease you have is galactosemia. Now what is galactosemia? This picture shows you few certain, the symptoms of galactosemia. We will learn in detail like how it affects an individual. Now galactosemia is a rare hereditary disorder of carbohydrate metabolism that affects the body's ability to convert galactose into glucose. So it is again autosomal recessive in inheritance, and this disorder is caused by a deficiency of an enzyme galactose 1-phosphate uridyl transferase, that is called as GALT gene, which is vital to this process of conversion of galactose to glucose. And the early diagnosis and treatment with a lactose-restricted diet is very much essential to avoid the symptoms of the disease. Now, this GALT gene that we spoke about is present on chromosome number 9, and this slide shows you how this GAL gene get inherited. This is also again autosomal recessive in inheritance, and it shows the pattern of autosomal recessive inheritance as we received earlier. When two carriers get married, they'll have four children, out of which one will be normal, one will be affected, and two will be carrier based on the number of copies of genes they receive. So the position of the GAL gene is on chromosome number 9. Now in this galactosemia, you have two different types based on what kind of enzyme is getting affected. Now in galactokinase, that is GALK, G-A-L-K, galactokinase deficiency, is associated with cataracts, increased blood concentration of galactose, and increased concentration of galcitol in the urine. Galcitol accumulates in the lens of the eye, where it causes lens swelling and protein precipitation, and subsequently it results in cataracts. And this GALK deficiency is an autosomal recessive genetic disorder caused by the mutations in the GALK1 gene and diagnosed by reduced GALK enzyme activity. Whereas the uridine diphosphate galactose 4 epimerase, that is GAL deficiency, is similar to GALT, but it is caused by the mutation in the GAL gene, that is the gene which is responsible for the production of this galactose 4 epimerase gene, and diagnosed by reduced GAL enzyme activity. Now this is a biochemical pathway that show you like how the GAL gene and the GAL gene, that is the epimerase, affects the conversion of galactose into glucose. Now what are the symptoms of this galactosemia? An infant with galactosemia appears normal at birth, but within a few days or weeks loses his or her appetite. So losing of appetite, it is called as anorexia, and it starts vomiting excessively. And then the other symptom includes yellowing of the skin, mucous membrane, and white portion of the eye, that is which results in jaundice. And hepatomegaly, that is enlargement of liver, is one more characteristic feature. Appearance of amino acids and protein in the urine, and growth failure, accumulation of fluid in the abdominal cavity with abdominal swelling, that is edema. Swelling is called as edema, and the accumulation of fluid, it's called as ascites. So these are certain symptoms of galactosemia. In addition to that, you can see brain damage, cataracts, jaundice, enlarged liver, and damage to kidney happening in the newborns because of unmetabolized milk. The sugar gets built up and results in damage to liver, eyes, kidney, and the brain. In addition to this, diarrhea, irritability, lethargy, and a bacterial infection may also be the early signs of galactosemia. Weakness, extreme weight loss, liver failure, kidney dysfunction, brain damage, speech and learning difficulties, even ovarian impairment is seen in girls with classic galactosemia. Now, what are the treatments, like how it can be corrected? Infants and children with galactosemia should have a lactose restricted diet, that is when whatever diet they take, the diet should be completely dairy free, because lactose mainly comes from the dairy products. So that diet should be dairy free or lactose free diet they should consider, so that there won't be further accumulation of galactose. Hormone replacement therapies may also be used in case of delayed puberty, and later in adolescence for the secondary loss of menstrual periods termed premature ovarian insufficiency. So hormonal replacement theory gives some kind of relief, but not a permanent cure. Now the next disease you have is cystic fibrosis. Now cysts means accumulation or formation of certain thick mucus like substances. Now what happens in cystic fibrosis is it mainly affects the lungs and the pancreas, and both these organs, they get stuffed with lot of mucus, because of which it blocks the normal airway, and it also obstructs the secretion of this pancreas getting into the digestive system. So that is the production of very thick mucus is a characteristic feature of this cystic fibrosis. Now let us learn what are the other characteristics of cystic fibrosis. This is commonly called as CF, that stands for cystic fibrosis. It is an inherited disease that affects the secretory glands, including the mucus and the sweat glands. Cystic fibrosis mostly affects the lungs, the pancreas, liver, intestine, sinuses, and sex organs also. And this CF is due to a mutation in the cystic fibrosis gene present on chromosome number 7. This CF gene encodes a protein known as cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator, which we call it as CFTR gene. And the main function of this CFTR is to regulate the movement of sodium ions in and out of the membranes. So the abnormal CFTR protein in patients with CF, it leads to disruption of chloride channels on the cells. And it is characterized by the present production of abnormal mucus that is excessively thick and sticky. And once this mucus becomes excessively thick and sticky, it blocks or it leads to blockages within the lungs and airways. This leads to repeated serious lung infection that can damage the lungs. Now the other symptoms of the disease include a permanent damage to the lungs, which can cause severe breathing problems. The thick sticky mucus also can block tubes or ducts in the pancreas. As a result, the digestive enzymes from the pancreas can't reach the small intestine, causing impaired absorption of fats and proteins, and this can cause vitamin deficiency and malnutrition. Due to the defect in chloride channels, cystic fibrosis also causes the sweat to become very salty. Now, what causes all these symptoms? The mutation in the CFTR gene causes cystic fibrosis, and it is this CFTR gene that provides instructions for making a channel that transports negatively charged particles called chloride ions into and out of cells. So when mutation occurs, mutation in this gene, it disrupts the function of chloride channels, preventing them from regulating the flow of chloride ions and water across cell membranes. As a result, cells that line the passageways of the lungs, pancreas, and other organs produce mucus that is unusually thick and sticky. Now this mucus clogs the airways and various ducts, causing the characteristic signs and symptoms of cystic fibrosis. And again we said this is an autosomal recessive inheritance because the gene is present on chromosome number 7, which is an autosome, and when the two carriers, a carrier father and a carrier male and a carrier female, when they get married, they will have one affected child, one normal child, and two of them being carriers. And this is how the gene gets inherited from one generation to the other. Now, what is the treatment for this? Cystic fibrosis has no cure. The treatment may include nutritional and respiratory therapies, medicines, exercise, and others which can ease out the symptom. Early treatment for cystic fibrosis can improve both quality of life and life span. Now the last and the next disease that we have to learn is thalassemia. So in thalassemia, what happens? You will have malformed red blood cells. Like if you see, look at this picture wherein we have put normal red blood cells on one hand and thalassemic blood cells on the other, you can make out the difference in both. Like how the structure of the red blood cells has been altered, which in turn results in thalassemia. Now, thalassemia is an inherited blood disorder wherein the body produces an inadequate amount of hemoglobin. Now, hemoglobin is a protein molecule that carries oxygen in the red blood cells. This disorder results in the extreme destruction of red blood cells that leads to anemia. It is an inherited disease which is mainly caused due to abnormal hemoglobin synthesis. Mild thalassemia requires no treatment, but acute thalassemia might require regular blood transfusion. Now, there are two types of thalassemia. One is alpha thalassemia and beta thalassemia. Now, we know that hemoglobin is a tetramer. It's a protein made up of four globulin chains in which it contains two alpha globulins and two beta globulins. So, whenever a mutation occurs in the alpha globulin, it is called as alpha thalassemia. And when the mutation takes place in the beta globulin, it is called as beta thalassemia. So in alpha thalassemia, it's a disorder in which one of the genes of the alpha globulin has a mutation or abnormality. And beta thalassemia, as I said, the genes of the beta globulin will become abnormal, or they are the ones which carry mutation. Now, what symptoms we find when a person is suffering from beta thalassemia? So beta thalassemia occurs in two different forms, namely thalassemia intermedia and thalassemia major. Some of the major signs of thalassemia major include paleness, jaundice, fussiness, poor appetite, and this kind of thalassemia is so serious that it needs frequent blood transfusion. Whereas thalassemia intermedia is less serious kind of beta thalassemia and it do not require blood transfusions and the symptoms can be managed. So beta thalassemia trait is found in individuals where there is only one HBB gene mutation in each cell possesses mild anemia. Whereas the symptoms of alpha thalassemia, it consists of two major forms, namely hydrops fetalis and or hemoglobin H disease. Hemoglobin H can be responsible for bone complexities. The forehead, cheeks and the jaw may overgrow and an intensively enlarged spleen is observed, and it also results in malnourishment. And this thalassemic disease is also autosomal recessive in inheritance. Here is the representation that shows how this beta thalassemic trait is carried from the parents to the next generation. One chromosome, the labeled with N, is the normal chromosome. The other one is with the beta thalassemia trait showed in orange color, and it gets inherited to two of the offsprings, who receives one normal chromosome and one with the trait. They will be the carriers. The other individual receives two blue chromosomes. They are absolutely normal. The other one receives the chromosome with the beta thalassemic gene, orange in both, and they will be the affected individual. They will suffer from thalassemia. So what could be the treatment of this? The treatment depends on its type and severity of the disease. Some of the treatments which are opted for maximum cases include bone marrow transplant, supplements and medications, and in some the blood transfusions and chelation therapy. it can be prevented. Thalassemia cannot be prevented since it is a genetically inherited disorder. However, these disorders can be detected during prenatal tests before birth. Also, genetic counseling helps to detect whether people have altered or missing hemoglobin gene that runs in their family, which results in thalassemia. Now, these are the certain references, links and certain textbook from which the content of this lecture has been taken. You can refer to them for further more information. I hope you have got enough information about these genetic diseases. Thank you for listening.